Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Prog-Watch. Tonight, you join us in the far meadow, where the atmosphere is very peaceful and tranquil. Various fish are swimming lazily. And in the distance, formal horses are quietly grazing. Suddenly, the peace is shattered by the arrival of a stampeding herd of Gabriels. And what seems to be a rather oversized Tiger Moth.
Hello, you fellows! It's Pete Jones from Tiger Moth Tales here. You're listening to Prog Watch with Anthony Rosick. Chocks away!
Thank you. days and nights that we know will be. I will stay with you, will you stay with me? Just one single tear in each passing year. I will follow you, will you follow me? Your other days and nights that we know will be. I will stay with you, will you stay with me? Just one single tear in each passing year. There will be.
That opening track was Follow You, Follow Me from the Peter Jones album Seven Stones Turned, which was released in 2016. So welcome back to another episode of Prog Watch. If you hadn't guessed, this is Prog Watch, and I am your friend and humble host, Big Tony Rousick, a.k.a. the Prog Squatch. This week we're going to be catching up with Peter Jones of Tiger Moth Tales, who had a hell of a year in 2016. I spoke to Peter in December of last year, and we'll get some of that interview rolling right away. But first, I want to let you know, we did have some problems with the connection. It was a bit dodgy at times, as my English friends like to say, but I think you'll get the gist of everything we were talking about. So let's get that interview going right now. Yeah, we haven't spoken since way back in January of this year, and boy, a lot of good things have been happening for you this year.
Yeah, it's been a bit, I can't really believe... Was it January? January spoke, was it?
It was January. I think at the time you had the Red Bazaar thing happening, but you weren't allowed to tell me about it yet.
Yeah, that's right. Yes. yeah, that was rather cool. Yes, obviously we did that.
How'd that all come to be?
The Red Bazaar thing all started before Cocoon. It was in 2014. When Cocoon was already finished, and I had played Cocoon a couple of times to Gary Marsh from Red Bazaar,
okay.
And we'd had a couple of jams, just him, me, and a drummer, Dave, and we had a couple of jams, sort of very surreal, just playing, sort of, you know, trying to work our way through Supper's Ready, you know, in some dodgy, damp basement studio in Mansfield, which is the town near where I live, you know, on a Saturday afternoon, which is something I personally have never done. But that was fun. And then, we got talking, and Gary, it emerged that Gary was in another band called Red Bazaar. He suggested to them that a collaboration might be interesting, because prior to that they'd always been instrumental,
right.
An instrumental band, and so therefore, you know, they'd done really well, you know, they had a lot of success and a following, especially sort of, you know, around here, you know, but being an instrumental group, I guess instrumental prog is more of a niche,
sure,
even more than prog is a niche, you know.
Yeah, so a little more limited. Yeah,
it's a niche within a niche. So we decided to have a go at writing something together, and we thought if it works, we'll try another one. And calling it, we did. And in many ways, I mean, I still have a very soft spot for that one, because it was the first one we did. That came off so well.
What was that one again? You kind of broke up there for a minute. Didn't hear which track.
It was Calling Her On.
Okay.
Or Calling Her Darren, as we seem to call it these days, or whatever. Calling Her Ron. That worked so well. I mean, we felt, to us, that felt like a good track. And the next thing we did was City in the Stars. And... Both with quite dark subtexts to them, dark lyrics, deep subjects. Not like I would usually write about in Tiger Moth Tales, as you know. My stuff is usually either quite happy and silly, or it might be somber, but it's never particularly dark. So that was quite a new avenue for me to pursue. And they all sort of turned out a bit dark, really. So yeah, it started out as one or two, and we kept going. And we thought, this is shaping up to be a pretty cool album. you know, I'm really quite glad with how well it's done, and obviously the reviews and stuff. I mean, I can't. It's always odd when you get a review that's come out sort of about 6 months after the album, which is what happened today, which you may have seen on Facebook.
I did see that. Yeah.
And it's like, oh, 6 months later, because to be honest, 6 months is really about the life of the shelf life of an album, isn't it? Really, it's like in terms of prog as well. You know, it's like, oh well, listen to it. If you're still listening to it in 6 months, then you're probably gonna it's probably going to be under your list of classics, sort of thing. But if you're not still listening to it in 6 months, you'll probably never listen to it again.
The fact
that somebody, I mean, they may have just discovered it. I'm guessing that's what's happened. But someone has just either discovered it or has got around to writing a review about it 6 months later, and that's quite cool that it's still getting a bit of attention. And to be honest, I put an awful lot of, well, we all did, put an awful lot of work into it, and I felt like for me it was kind of. It's been my album for the year as well, because it's been my biggest and best sort of contribution in terms of output this year, I suppose. That's what I'm trying to say, I suppose. But you know, we're all really pleased on how it came out, and we've enjoyed rehearsing it and doing it live as well, which we've only done once up until now, but we've got some more gigs in December. So yeah, Red Bazaar was really cool, and it's continuing to be so. And of course, the guys from Red Bazaar very kindly agreed to be the Tiger Moth Tales backing band as well.
Okay, so I wanted to ask you about that, because you had a big gig a month or so back, and you made it available to us folks on Progzilla Radio to check out, and I did. And I was wondering who all was in the band on that recording. And are you planning on releasing that? Is that what you've been working on?
We're not planning on releasing that. it's always a bit of a thing with live recordings, isn't it? Because that one was literally out of the desk. You know, should we wish to how can I put this, polish it in any way? That's not really doable, because you know you know what I'm trying to say. I mean,
so it was just like a two track or something. You didn't have all the individual tracks recorded independently.
And it was our first gig, and there are bits where we kind of listen to it and go, oh God, you know, that was a bit of a bum note there.
It wasn't that bad. I heard it.
I mean, at the end of the day, I'm really glad we got a recording of it, because just for the vibe, you know, it was such, I mean, obviously the first time for Tiger Moth Tales as a full band.
Yeah, historic. They're going to look back someday, and they're going to say, this is the date when it all, you know.
I remember hearing on the news something about somebody naming a railway station after a bank or something. Something like they named a station like Barclays Station or NatWest Station or something. And I remember the newsreader saying that it was a historic moment. And I thought, is that historic because it's never happened before? In which case, I mean, I've never eaten a rhinoceros. So I suppose it would be historic if I did that, but it wouldn't be particularly interesting. But yes, I mean, to us it is kind of historic. And of course, it was the first time Red Bazaar had done with that lineup and playing that music. So it was great for us, and it was great to capture it. And the crowd, as you've heard, I mean, that is a very secret bootleg.
Yeah.
Hear that they are sort of really up for it and enjoying themselves.
Yeah,
we got more people in than we thought.
Yeah, you had a partisan crowd, definitely.
I don't know what prog gigs are like in the USA, you know, but I mean, we got 50 people in, which for us, for a first-time gig, we thought, that's not too bad at all, bearing in mind, you know, sometimes you can have two or three bands playing, and you get about, you know, 30 people in. It's very... Very unreliable in terms of numbers. I don't know if you find that in the US. So what's your kind of thing with that?
Yeah, it's tough. Prague isn't quite as big here in the US as it is in the UK. So I think you probably have more like Prague bands that are actually out playing little gigs around, you know. And whereas over here, it's not so much. You know, you might get the big names coming through occasionally. You know.
Yeah. I suppose I've never really thought about that, but I suppose, yeah, I mean, and it's weird that you get bands like Spock's Beard and Sound of Contact, you know, coming over here to gig, you know. It's like a hell of a long way to come and do a, like a 3 or 4 gigs or whatever. But I guess we have a bit more of a prog vibe. Going on. But then I think perhaps in like Italy and Germany, they have an even bigger vibe, perhaps. I don't know.
Yeah, I was talking to Oliver Rusing. I'm still practicing the rolling R, but yeah, he said it's pretty big in Germany. You know, I had him on my show a couple weeks ago, and he said it's real big in Germany. You know, so maybe you need to get over on that over there. You know, you'll be huge in Germany.
You're huge in
the UK. I mean, I'm trying to help make you more huge over here because I think you're brilliant, man.
Well, you heard Peter talking about his collaboration with Red Bazar in that last segment. And let's hear some of that wonderful collaboration right now. This is Lights of Home from the Red Bazar album Tales from the Bookcase, released last year.
Far from the lights of home, they sailed. Sailed for glory, death or glory. A chance to redeem what had gone before. Change the story. Out they went into that endless white night. Tired and frozen, scared and frozen. Many a sailor heard the call of death, and many were chosen.
Plunging down again.
Went back to Valerie.
safe. As the ship plowed on towards them, we wept to see their burning faces change from hope to horror as we mowed them down.
Once again, that was Peter Jones and Red Bazar from the Red Bazar album Tales from the Bookcase, released in 2016. Now let's get back to the interview.
Somebody asked me if I was... I told them I was going to Japan with Camel, and then they said, "Are you big in Japan?" You know, and I said, you know, that's in the song. And I said, "Well, I'm pretty much big everywhere, but that's just because of the size of me, you know. I'll be ginormous in Japan, you know."
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Trust me, I would be. I'm like 6 feet 7 inches tall. I'd be like three heads taller than everybody.
But yeah, so I mean,
I forgot about the Camel thing. Yeah, I forgot all about that. Hey, you did that too, man.
Yeah, that was awesome. That's one of the best things I've done in a very, very long time, you know. I want to tell this story. It sounds awfully like, in fact, I may have mentioned this when we spoke in January, because obviously the initial conversations with Camel first started around this time last year.
Yeah.
So I don't know if I told this story already, but I like to tell it, even though it's incredibly name-droppish. You know, it's very, very lot of
drop away, name-dropping
going on. But the story basically goes that a guy, Barry Lenton, a friend of Andy's, had given him Cocoon's CD, and obviously haven't had a especially good run of luck with their keyboard players of late, I think. Well, I mean, obviously, I'm joking apart. Guy LeBlanc died sadly last year, of course, yeah. And Ton Gerpenziel can't fly. He's got a real bad fear of flying, which kind of discludes anywhere anywhere you can't go by train. And I think they worked with Jason Hart last year, but things. I think he's doing other stuff now, isn't he? He's doing something on Broadway, is it? Some kind of musical thing he's doing.
Sure.
I think, but he's doing other avenues, and obviously he's doing his thing. So I think, I mean, I can only attribute it to the fact they were thinking, bloody hell, we need a keyboard player, because you know, and I still to this day I'm amazed that they would ask me, knowing that there are people, you know, there are so many other fantastic keyboard players far better established, you know, and far better, far bigger names, you know, than myself. So it still astounds me. But anyway, the story goes that he gave the CD to Andy must have liked what he heard, and so I got this email from Andy Latimer saying, "We wondered if you'd like to join Camel and do some shows in Japan with us." And I was thinking, well, yes, I really would. I mean, to come other, I mean, I always have to check and see what other jobs I've got. Obviously, try and move them, but
yeah.
So I was well up for it. But I had to send him back this reply, because he asked me to send a version of Ice. He said, "Can you do me an audition of Ice and send that to me, you know, and so I can check it out, sort of thing." And I had to send him the email, sort of saying, "Yes, no problem. I'd love to do that. Only thing is, I can't do it this weekend. I'll have to wait till next week because I'm off to Cumbria this weekend to play with Francis Dunnery and Robert Plant."
Wow.
Which is one of the oddest emails I've ever had to send. So like I say, very very name very name dropping. But
yeah, that's a
yes.
good story.
the audition went down well. My brief was basically to come as near to Kit Watkins as possible.
How tough was that? I mean, did you have a hard time learning the repertoire? Or?
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, for that particular track, Ice, the sound was quite tricky to get, because it's quite an interesting sound on the lead. It's not like a square wave or anything. It's quite a sort of interesting sound. And as for getting near to what Kit was doing on that track, I actually like those instructions, because I mean, don't get me wrong, I'm more than happy to do my own thing with something. But the trouble when you do your own thing with something, especially something as classic as that, you know, you run the risk of sort of potentially ruining it for everyone else, or you know, or it starts to get a bit bitty, you know.
Yeah.
So I was quite glad of that briefing and that's how I approached all of it. Really, I mean, obviously there was Kit Watkins, and obviously the majority of the stuff was from Peter Bardens, and it's just such a joy to play. Really, fantastic music. Really, I mean, there are some nice noodly bits, but a lot of great feeling parts as well. And, you know, Camel, to me, always seem to like to write songs. So within the prog parts, you know, there are really great songs as well. And, yeah, just a joy to do. And they seemed to like what I did. I mean, we had a four piece, which they haven't done for a while, I believe. I don't know how long, but I think it's for at least the last few tours. They've had two keyboard players. So I think that was a bit of a interesting thing to try and make it work. I mean, there's things you have to compromise, and sometimes you have to cut bits out. But no, everybody seemed really pleased with how it went, and I had a ball. You know, it was just and they're just fantastic guys as well. You know, I sound very showbiz shite and all, but but you know, they are lovely. All I mean, the guys are lovely. Colin and Andy and Denis and the whole management team and the roadies and everyone. They just it does. To use a cliche, it does feel like a family sort of thing, and I just had an incredible time.
That's cool. Yeah.
You know, I really hope we'll do it again. You know.
Yeah. Any recordings of that? Do you know if they made any recordings of any of the live dates? Any plans on a live album?
Sorry, I was just I had a quick sip of my beer then.
Oh, that's all right. Yeah.
I don't know. I believe that there were video cameras filming some of the tour, whether that was being done for their own use or I really don't know. It'd be absolutely super if there was something.
Yeah.
Some kind of live thing that came out, but I really don't know. I'm sorry.
Well, yeah, if you find out, I'm sure you'll let us know, huh?
I would believe me. If something does come out, I shall be telling the world about it.
All right. Yeah. Well, you should. You know.
You know. I'm very very proud. I mean, very proud to be a part of it. I mean, I know Camel is not like Genesis in that. I think since like 90, I think it was 77. I think Andy has been the only constant. Well, I know he's been the constant for all the way from the beginning, but
right.
But obviously they've had different bassists, different drummers, keyboard players and stuff. I mean, Denis, believe it or not, he's been in the band for 16 years, so that's pretty long way right. Back you're going. And Colin has been in the band since 1979, so he's a pretty firm fixture at this point.
Kind of like, yes, you know, Alan White, he's been in there for, you know, he may not be the original drummer, but he's sure been there a long time.
So, I mean, and of course they were out there in the original Vanguard, you know, with Genesis and King Crimson and Pink Floyd and all that. And I did really try to sort of to take it in as I was doing it, just to kind of remember it all and savor the moment.
That's great. Yeah.
Just remember thinking in Lady Fantasy that there's as you may know that there's quite a long bit where Andy does his solo, and depending on how he's feeling, it could be 2 or 3 minutes, or it could be about 6 minutes, 10 minutes. You know?
Yeah.
it depends how good he thinks it's going, I think. And I just sat there going doing my little keyboard bit, which is. And I'm sat there and I'm thinking, I always wanted to be, when I was a kid, actually to be Tony Banks. You know, I actually dreamt of being Tony Banks in Genesis. Yeah. And I'm thinking, and now I'm Peter Jones in Camel.
Yeah. Hey.
Which is pretty...
yeah, it's great, man.
Pretty awesome, really. You know, yeah. I still... You know, it sounds like I'm being a bit sort of... I'm trying to be modest or whatever, but I really can't believe... You know, some of the things I've been able to do in the last year or so, the last couple of years.
Yeah, that's why.
Really,
and to give you another ring, man.
These opportunities, you know, it's it really is pretty unbelievable to me. So, you know, I feel very lucky and very glad to be able to take part in these things.
Let's take a little break from the chat and listen to another song. This one is Storytellers by Pete's main project, Tiger Moth Tales, from the album Storytellers Part 1, released in 2015.
Upon a time is how it all began. Pictures from the mind of a woman or a man. Words from the pen streets of stone, scenes of time gone by, or futures yet unknown. Words on the page, the players on the stage, and you're there.
Again, that was the title track from the latest Tiger Moth Tales album, Storytellers Part 1 from 2015. Now let's get back to Peter.
And you've also kept up a steady diet of playing live, you know, your own stuff. And you did that stuff for Guide Dogs. You did Peter Jones Sings Genesis. You put out a couple of those.
Yeah. Not the sort of thing I have ever been able to do before. In the day job that I say day job, it's a weekend night job really, but the gigs I generally do, which are pub and club gigs, are all, you know, I sing covers for those, and that's what I've done for 16 years. And I enjoy singing covers. You know, I'm a great fan of pop music, you know, of all eras, and I enjoy doing that, but it's not the kind of place you can ever do in proggy. I think maybe like literally once or twice in the course of 16 years have I actually had a conversation with somebody about Genesis or Pink Floyd or whatever. So, yeah, to be able to now actually go, I mean, I sing these songs, I sing like More Fool Me live or Musical Box or whatever, when I do my solo acoustic Tiger Moth Tales gigs. And to be able to record them as well and to put my own slant on them and to know that, just to be able to sing these songs in public for an audience who, I mean, as I said, when I was at the Borderline, I'm name dropping again. Here we go, supporting Moon Safari. I sang for Absent Friends, and I got the in the middle of the first verse. I sang the line from the second verse. I sang leaving tuppence on the plate, and I could hear the audience singing the right words, and I thought, I said after the song, I said it's to get the words wrong in a Genesis song and have the audience actually notice or care, you know, and, yeah. And sort of be able to steer you right. It's not something I'm used to. So, yeah, that was cool, doing the Genesis stuff, and people have seemed to have liked my takes on, I mean, a couple of, like, Invisible Touch and Follow You, Follow Me, where I went a bit rogue. And
I liked your Follow You. I liked it a lot. I think I played it on a show a few months back, yeah.
Oh, cool. But I just thought it was worth, I mean, I don't know what kind of audience we're talking about, really, in terms of numbers. But I, you know, people, obviously, people. I mean, you're never going to change people's minds. But there are a lot of people who really can't stand Invisible Touch, particularly, and the more and when they went into the pop era of their careers.
Yeah.
And I just thought it'd be quite interesting to take the song apart and do it again in a different style and see if it changes people's opinions of the actual song, which to a degree was quite successful, you know. So that was quite cool.
Yeah, very. I mean, cool.
In terms of Invisible Touch, I mean, I think I went a bit far with that one and sort of tried to turn it into some kind of. I mean, it was as if Steve Hackett never left the band, and then decided to do a nylon guitar version of Invisible Touch, which some people might read as a bit of an insult to Steve Hackett. I don't know. But I was playing it to my mate, and it got about 5 minutes through the song, and he suddenly worked out what it was. So that's how, you know, far apart I went with that one. But no, it was good, great fun to do. Really, really, I must say this, since we're on the air, I must say that, you know, really, for everybody who did invest in either selling England for a pound or seven stones turned, you know, I really appreciate that because, I mean, I haven't actually given the money to Guide Dogs yet because I'm still letting it mount up. But I think at the end of the, it's coming up to the end of the year, so I will sort of be shortly presenting the check to Guide Dogs, and it's quite a substantial amount now, so we really do appreciate that.
That's fantastic. It really is, yeah. So, I guess that also brings up, after those albums, then you even guested on the Colin Tench Project album.
That old thing. Yeah.
That whole thing, yeah.
didn't you do something on that?
Me?
Yeah.
No. I talked to Colin a few weeks beforehand, and yeah, I had a little advance. Oh, everyone else? Hey, I would if you want me. You know, I'll howl on it.
That was a rude joke of mine in terms of the credit list for the album, which is absolutely ginormous. But nonetheless, I mean, how you can pull something together like that, I don't know. I mean, Colin is. I think Colin's great at sort of getting people you know, getting people, I think, and pulling something like that together. And obviously, most of it done on file sharing, so none of us have met.
Yeah.
And yeah, Colin first asked me about that. I'm trying to think when it would have been. I think it was somewhere around the time when Progzilla had its anniversary.
Okay.
So that would have been, I think it was the beginning of March, I think, or the end of February. Yeah, end of February, I think it was. And Colin, I think, had just asked me about And So Today, which was the first one we did.
Right.
And I got talking to him on account of the fact that he did these unbelievable reviews for Cocoon and Storyteller. You know, I mean, certainly the depth of the reviews and the compliments. I mean, he particularly complimented me on my sound quality, which and my mixing and stuff, which given the equipment that I'm using is quite something, really.
Yeah.
Because I'm using all the old, well, antique gear, which isn't even professional. It's semi-pro, so it's not even, you know, decent gear by most people's standards. So yeah, he gave me some great feedback, and then we worked on And So Today, which was we've just put a video out, actually, which people seem to be enjoying, and it's about the musical legends that we've lost in the past. It references various people like David Bowie and Sir George Martin. I'm not supposed to say, because I think you must try and work it out for yourself, but
yeah, okay.
There's cryptic lyrics that Colin wrote. So we did that, and then we did part 4B, which is just absolutely mad. Mm-hmm. And then we did part 3, and then we did part 1. So yeah, it was really, really great. I think it's the mark of something, a great creation, because I was quite interested in doing the first one because it was quite a great topic and a quite serious, poignant song. And then the second one, I think, I thought, oh, okay, we could do another one. And then by the time I'd done the second one, I was thinking, oh, I wouldn't mind doing another one actually now. And then Colin asked me about that, and he said, well, just one more, because I don't want to give you too much stuff to do, because I was trying to rehearse for Camel and stuff at the time. And so I did the third one. And then after that, I thought, oh, that's quite sad, actually. I wouldn't mind doing another one now. And I sort of approached him then and said, is there anything else you want me to do? So yeah, I kind of got hooked into it, you know, as we were doing it. So, and it's a fantastic album. I mean, I think it's like, is it all 80 minutes of it? It's great.
It's pretty long, yeah.
Yeah. And there's just so much on there, you know, lot to take in. And yeah, it's just fantastic. Yeah.
It's kind of what he does. It's all over the place, but it's always interesting, in my opinion. I like his free thinking, you know?
Yeah. Well, we have a similar mindset, because we both love the White Album by the Beatles, as a for instance, which is obviously, I mean, a lot of people say that should have been a single album and they could have got rid of half of it, which I totally don't agree with. And I love the fact that it just goes all over the place, and one minute you've got a dodgy, like, music hall song, next minute you've got, like, something that was more Led Zeppelin than Led Zeppelin was, and they weren't even around then.
Right.
And, you know,
right.
And it's just all over the place. It's just a wonderful mishmash.
Yeah.
And nothing to my mind is wasted or lost. You know, it's just a brilliant album. And Colin's like that as well. You know, and he likes to just to take people by surprise, as do I. I mean, you know, with Cocoon, you know, there's still a lot of people will openly tell me that they usually skip the Isle of Witches, for instance. You know, and when I did that one, I thought to myself, should I really put this on, really? And in the end, I just had to, because it was kind of very much in the spirit of what I was about, of childhood and imagination and making up stories and that kind of thing, and it was from my childhood, so I had to put it on.
I think that's the first one. I think that's the first song from you I ever played on my show, The Isle of Witches.
Really?
Yeah.
I think you've played it. I think Marty's played it, and I think a guy at Delicious Agony. I'm just mentioning loads of other radio stations here, which is
right.
You know, but yeah, we're all friends, aren't we?
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah,
a guy called Rick. I guess so. Bunch of amateurs. Rick DeShiel played the Isle of Witches on his show, and I think he played it because I think he often, I may be wrong, but I think he often plays rather avant-garde type stuff, and I think he only likes to play the weirdest stuff. And sure enough, from Cocoon, that was the track he chose to play.
Yeah,
because it was the weirdest.
Yeah, I gravitated to it. A Kid's Tale. I love that too. That was fantastic.
There you are. Well, we're obviously of a similar mindset here, which is either good or alarming, depending on how you look at it.
In that segment, we talked a little about some of Peter's live work and his support for the Guide Dogs charity. The show opener came from the second live album he released called Seven Stones Turned, but he put out another one before that, Selling England for a Pound, in 2015. From that one, I'd like to play a wonderful stripped-down arrangement of the Genesis classic, The Musical Box.
I may join with you. All your hearts now seem so far from me. Hardly seems to matter now. And the nurse will tell you lies of a kingdom beyond the skies, but I am lost within this half world. Hardly seems to matter now. Bring me my song. Here it comes again. My song, here it comes again. Just a little bit. Time left to live out my life. La 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 la.
smile. Oh, brush back your hair. I want to get to know your flesh just a little bit. I've been waiting here for so long. And all this time you pass me by. Honey seems to matter now. Not now. Stand there with your fixed expression.
Again, that was The Musical Box by Peter Jones from one of his two live albums, which benefit the Guide Dogs charity. Selling England for a Pound was the album that one came from. When I post this show to my website, progwatch.com, I will have links for you to find those albums and all of Peter's works, which were featured in this show. So look for that and show some love.
Yeah, back to the White Album. I get it 100%. You know, it's everything on it. I even listened to Revolution 9 and, you know, it's just like some of the funny little conversation bits, you know. I mean, they're classic, you know.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I don't know if right at the beginning, if you turn it really loud, you can hear George Martin talking to a sound engineer about some wine or something. And it's this like really sort of camp sounding conversation about champagne or something. It's like if I'd known you wanted that, darling, I'd have got it for you.
Yeah.
I can't remember what he says, but it's something. Like, I can't think of the word, but yeah, I think camp is a reasonable word.
Yeah.
And it's something I didn't notice till very recently.
Take this, brother. May it serve you well.
Yeah.
And there's so many of them, you know.
Brilliant. Yeah,
some people would just skip that over. No, not me.
Well, I played that on my show the other day, followed by Let's Eat Grandma, who I've been championing recently. They're an English act, and I told my wife, I said, you've just missed Revolution 9, followed by Let's Eat Grandma, because she nipped out to the shops, and she went, oh, thank God for that. Because that would have been a bit too weird. But those two tracks, one after the other.
No, but, you touched on that. The Beatles could get away with it. Even Led Zeppelin, to some degree, they got away with it. When you look, I mean, Hot Dog, that's like their attempt at a country song, you know. Jamaica, you know, it's them doing Led Zeppelin reggae, you know. And they could do the Led Zeppelin 3 album.
All my life, this was the problem. All my songwriting career, this was the problem for me, that I could never stick to one genre. But I never saw the point. What's the point in getting yourself stuck in one particular thing? Right. I mean, you mentioned the Led Zeppelin. I mean, another one, Night at the Opera by Queen. I mean, that's
right.
That's from full on metal to musical.
Yeah, old musical, yeah.
Like some other crazy space travel thing or whatever it was, and then obviously the things like what's it called? The Prophet song. You know, that's full on prog.
Yeah.
You know?
All the weird echo stuff.
And it's got, I think, has it got My Best Friend on that album as well?
That's on there, yep.
Which is like a just good old almost Motown type thing going on, you know. How can you categorize that? I mean, I suppose that usually comes from four different band members, as in the case of Queen and the Beatles, just as welcome in a solo artist, as far as I'm concerned, you know. And I think I just find those artists more interesting.
So you know, I
mean,
and having the guts to do it too. I mean, you know, not just you know because so many bands, I think they end up. And this is where I think the downfall of music came is when everything had to fit in the box and you had A&R guys saying, well, you have to write a song that sounds just like the three hits off your last album. You have to write Son of your last hit every time, you know, and then Aerosmith coming out basically writing the same song for about 10 years there. It was the same power ballad almost to the T. And it's just like, man, where did we go wrong here? There's no creativity or adventurousness left here, you know?
I recorded an interview with Andy Latimer for a Progzilla show, which hasn't even come out yet. So I should stop saying what I'm about to say. But Andy was talking. Andy was talking about that and recording albums in the 70s and saying that the record, you know, at that time, you know, they didn't get involved. You know, they didn't come in to the studio and say, you know, what are you doing? You can't do that. You know, and it was a really exciting time to record because you had this sort of this freedom. And then you hear stuff about, like, in the 80s, you know, I've just, I was reading Phil Collins' autobiography just recently and talking about how the record companies wanted people to do a particular thing or, like, yeah, do the same as you did last time, but better, or just rewrite what you've written. Yeah, it does seem like something went a bit wrong somewhere down the line, which is why the 70s was such a exciting era and why now people do kind of hark back to that. I mean, you get a lot of stick for sort of looking back to the 70s because people say, well, we want to progress and move on from the 70s. But to my mind, I mean, our minds are still being blown, you know, by Lamb Lies Down or you know, whatever, or Moon Madness or, you know, whatever album it is, we're still being washed away by that. So I kind of take it. I think it's a great thing that a lot of bands still want to take on the spirit of that.
Yes.
Which is why you see a lot of albums saying, you know, that they take elements of 70s prog and, you know, people still, what they want to kind of capture and get back to that spirit of freedom, you know, and no matter how you, and the other thing is, I mean, no matter how you try and get around it, I mean, I've taken the piss out of can you say piss on your show?
Sure.
twice. I've taken the mickey out of bands who use Mellotrons and say, oh look, we must be prog because we've got a Mellotron. But you know, at the end of the day, it's just a bloody good sound. You know, you've got people using the same R's and string sounds and choir sounds and stuff that, I mean, I don't know if these people ever got paid royalties. If you know, these people who recorded the original samples, they ought to be billionaires by now.
Yeah, you're right.
But yeah, you know, it's a fantastic sound. And if you stop using those sounds and use something else, someone's gonna chime up and say, "Oh, I don't like these new modern sounds people are using." So you can't bloody win. But we strayed a little from what we were talking about.
I love Mellotron. I was so excited when I got a decent sounding plug-in for my own little setup and. I don't drench everything in it, but it's cool to have it. You know, when you want it, you know, it's there. And it does, it creates that certain vibe, you know? It just...
I mean, I never have any plugins. I don't use them. I just use my old Technics workhorse. And sometimes I've kind of made a bit of a thing about the fact that I don't have a Mellotron. I'm thinking, you know, I say, well, nobody else is using a Technics KN6000 for their prog. But at the same time, I do try and sometimes reproduce Mellotron sounds, you know, with the R's and, you know, the strings and whatever. Right. You know, I do, and flutes and that kind of, I do try and reproduce it. So I'm as guilty as the next Mellotron user, really. And obviously when I did the Camel stuff, there were tracks where I had to try and get as near to a Mellotron as I could. So, you know, it's a fab sound. But yes, I think the great thing about prog for me, because I did struggle all my life with with songwriting and people saying, you know, well, you've got one song that sounds like, you know, country, and you've got one song that sounds like Bryan Adams, and then you've got something else that sounds like a James Taylor track, and then something else that sounds like a Backstreet Boys ballad or something, something crazy. Yeah. And I'm thinking, well, yeah, because what's the point in writing songs that sound all the same? And people would say, we need to get you to have your own sound and to be in your own, to find your sort of your genre or whatever.
Yeah.
And that's why prog in a way was an eye opener for me to be able to record prog, because I just thought, if I want to do a little musical bit in the middle of it, I can do that. If I want to do metal in the middle of something, I can do that. If I want to go Indian, I can do that. If I want to have a little singing goat section, I can.
Yeah, I can do and that. Yeah, and, yeah. And then that is your style, and your voice is your voice, and you know, and people. Regardless, it's still, like I said, when Zeppelin did a country song, it didn't sound very country. It was still Led Zeppelin, but it was basically Hot Dog, you know? It was still like basically a country song, but it was them. It was still Led Zeppelin. So what you're doing, it may take from different influences and styles, but it's still Peter Jones music.
And speaking of Peter Jones music, here's one from the first Tiger Moth Tales album that shows that Pete has a light heart and doesn't like to take things too seriously. This is The Merry Vicar from the first Tiger Moth Tales album, Cocoon, released in 2014.
Thank you. spreading the word with a wink and a nod. He's doing a lot of good for God. He's giving the church a bit of a prod. Three cheers for me.
Hip hip and three cheers indeed. Again, that was The Merry Vicar from Cocoon by Tiger Moth Tales in 2014. Now we'll finish up that interview.
All right, well, so what do you have cooking? What are you going to be up to? How are you going to build on this year? You know, it's been a hell of a year for you.
But I dearly love to go out and do some more stuff with Camel. I'd like to do more work with Francis. That's the other thing. I played a couple of keyboard on a couple of his tracks on his Return to the Wild Country album. I played keyboard on Peace in Our Time and Jackal in Your Mind. So that was great to be able to play on those. And I'm just enjoying working with such cool people. There's another project that I'm working on, which I can't really. I don't think I'm at liberty to say what it is.
Another. It's, dropping a hint or whatever, yeah.
Well, it's a band who I've written some lyrics with, and they've asked me to sing on a couple of the tracks on their album, but I can't say who it is. So, but that'll be out next year. So, it'll be amazing to see how that goes down. And they are really I wish I could tell you who it is, because they are really really excellent.
The secret life excellent of Peter band.
They're Italian. That's all I'll say.
Wow, that brings a few to mind.
Well, doesn't narrow the field that much, but
can I ask more modern or older classic?
They're pretty modern.
All right, we'll leave it at that. I don't want to pressure you.
Whoops, had to stop there as Pete was just about to tell me the name of the band that he is hopefully working with soon. I know, I'm such a tease. But I will tell you that the news is really awesome, and when it is official, I will make sure to share it with you. But for now, let's finish things off with a tune from the Colin Tench Project album, Hair in a G-String, on which Peter collaborated. The name of the song is Hair in a G-String 3, I'm Going Down.
It's not what we thought, apparently. A recent inquiry succinctly made the case. It's all down, 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 down.
Wait, what am I saying?
Everything's fine,
fine, fine.
What might be true is a view. A Brazilian is better than doing nothing at all.
Do you follow me?
I know traffic's bad today. This is good, touching wood. Where do you go?
I suppose you don't know.
I don't know, I don't know.
We don't know, we don't know.
Suppose that I say you're not leaving today.
Stay where you are and play that guitar.
Woo!
So good.
Put it together and what do you get?
Goodity, goodity, good.
Disagree, but when all is said and done, love is annoying.
how life is, and long may it be. Just on a whim, I think I'll give this a trim. I'm going down, 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 down,
and that's about all we have time for. So remember to prog on, brothers and sisters.